Hi there, Robin here, and welcome to the Happy Infectious Faces Project. The prior video, part one, was lightly covering the proportions and ratios of the face. We're going to build from the last tutorial with this image to this painting. In this video, I'm going to apply what is said in the previous video to real life. Let's be practical. Yes, I make a big mistake here, which is important, and I also erase it and build from there. I wanted to show you this because the eraser is my best friend. So if you like this kind of video, please subscribe and hit the bell icon to all to be informed when I post another video. So let's begin. I create this project, the Happy Infectious Faces Project, by asking people to send me their happy, goofy, silly faces in photo. And happily, people have been sending me their images with odd angles and facial expressions. So what you have to do is paint them, but you still follow certain rules so that the image makes sense and reads well. The bone structure of people, unless they have been altered in some way, either by accident or birth defect or birth difference or surgery, is always usually the same. And this is important to remember. I'm doing these images as an exercise for myself, but I'm sharing what I've learned with you. And it's also become, well, quite challenging, to be honest. And here is what I'm learning. I'm going to share with you what I have learned from this challenge. It is the soft tissue that is moving around the basic structure, the bones, that is interesting. All these faces are made unique and have different genetics to make the proportions slightly different, but they all have to work around defined bone structure perimeters. The heads move through space, but the proportions and ratios are always the same. Those stay the same. It is important to identify so that these images look natural and not awkward. If I were to do caricatures or cartoons, that might be a little bit different and yet still similar. It would still be the same because you would have to follow certain rules so that it makes sense and you can find more humor in it. Like I said in the last video, once you know the rules, then you can break them. And this is really important because you don't want to struggle with your art because something is wrong and you can't figure it out because you don't have the knowledge of why. You might not know how the body is put together and then add something, remove something, or never include it, and it will always look wrong. So, you know, it's a little bit helpful to start well by, you know, I hate to say it, pardon the pun, give it good bones. And, well, it is the bones that are your important stay part, but it's also at the discretion or the limitations of the soft tissue, being muscles, skins, nerves, color, which would come from blood vessels and that sort of thing. You can exaggerate, but you can't invent without it looking weird or wrong. I work with the standard proportions and then look at how they are as individuals and work from there. I guess when you put the good structure down, the basic proportions and the idea of where the bones are, and then focus on how their soft tissue is moving and reading. This is a key point. The layout is to get the basic, largest shape in first, and then decide what will be the key shape and from everything that everything else will work around. In this case, I used the glasses. I didn't use the person. I used the glasses. They're big, they're solid, and they're going to be the focus because she's looking past those glasses. So I focused on getting the glasses accurate in relation to the face shape. And then I get the bones behind them in. Once I do this, once I do the larger shapes and being aware of the sizes and the reference to the main structures, the glasses and the face, then it works. Once I'm happy with that, I then look for smaller shapes and make them accurate in relation to the glasses and build from there. It's refine, refine, refine. In the glasses are her eyes, or behind the glasses are her eyes, and once they are a certain distance in proportion inside the glasses. So once the eyes are laid out in reference to the photo, I then look at the iris of the eye and make sure that the whites of the eyes match the shape to the reference. They're going to be maybe triangular or a certain distance, and I will make sure to get those right because this will help me to center the pupil and her iris, and so that it makes sure that she has the same glance as the image does. I will then do this with all parts of the face, like the nose and all the shapes. For example, the nose have the wings of the nose and its shapes that it creates around it. So then I will also look at the distance to the eyes, to the distance to the shin. I will use my pencil to help me measure, and I will measure the eye and see maybe if it's the same width as the nose. Or where is it that it's the same size? Maybe the length of the nose is the same width as the lens of her glasses. And maybe it's the shape of a triangle. This is kind of math without numbers. It's proportion, ratio of shapes and sizes. It's how everything relates to everything else. It's sort of a math, but by comparison and rough measure. So it's easier than numbers, but it makes you estimate more. So you have to hone in your observation skills. Drawing for me is the bones of the painting. If you don't get the basics down and accurately down, the painting for me looks odd. And that's what the main lesson is with these sketches, is that I gotta get the bones down right, the basics, the proportions down right first. So I use paint later on to help me make the sketch look better and better understand, and then how light works. But in this lesson, it's about proportions, ratios, so how everything relates to each other. It's not about painting today, it's about drawing. And this is about getting your layout down right. Make your mistakes here so you can correct them, because when you put the paint on later, it is much harder to correct, especially with things like watercolor. I do have a little more advice for you, and this is to keep your pencil marks light at first. So when you keep your relationship with your eraser friendly, believe me, you'll be able to move around your pencil marks and change and add easily. Your eraser cannot fix how you abuse your paper. So be kind to yourself and go lightly and then build up, and your paper and your eraser will work with you. So there you go. That is this tutorial part for, part two. If you like this kind of video, please let me know in the comments below. And if you have any helpful hints that you would like to share with other artists, please leave those in the comments below as well. Everybody can learn from each other. Consider subscribing and stay in the loop for what I'm doing in the future. And we'll talk to you soon.